Hello and welcome back to the channel. Today we'll continue our discussion on robot kinematics, more specifically to talk about inverse kinematics. A little bit of a recap. So far we discussed a number of topics on kinematics so far. We began with the frame matrix. We defined the meaning of the frame matrix and its importance to robot kinematics. We also talked about parameters and some features, unique features of the frame matrix, such as the inverse and also and other features that we discussed earlier. Then we moved on to talk about transformations. And that was when we talked about, once we understood the concept of kinematics or the concept of the frame matrix, then we moved on to talk about transformations, which is how do you transform a frame from one state to another? Basically how to change its position and orientation from the start to the end. And we talked about a number of topics related to transformations, such as, first of all, we talked about linear transformations, then rotary transformations and the differences. Then we talked about the importance of coordinate system, such as global and local, and the effects of the transformation on them. And we talked about as well about graphical based, when you have a diagram, how do you work with it? And we solved a number of examples on that. And we finally talked about symbolic operations, which is really the purpose of doing kinematics to begin with, which is to perform the various operations that we've done, that we worked with so far in symbolic or in equations rather than on unique or values. We performed a number of actions and we developed matrices using operations or symbolic or variables, and then we found a corresponding matrix. So that was our second sort of stop at kinematics. And in last session, we talked about forward kinematics. And we saw how in forward kinematics, the most important part of forward kinematics really is to have the robot matrix ready. Once you have the robot matrix developed, then it's just a matter of substitution. And we saw that, again, we revised the concept of kinematics and or the importance of the robot frame matrix or the frame matrix. And then we talked about the robot matrix in this sense, that we can say that a whole robot can be modeled with a single matrix that would involve inside of it the variables that correspond to robot parameters. And once this matrix is developed, then it's just a matter of substitution. So our first work or our first job in that particular session was to develop the robot matrix. So we saw how we did that in a number of industrial standard robots, such as the Cartesian robot, the cylindrical robot, the spherical. And we also talked about planar robots, such as the two-dimensional planar robots and the three-dimensional planar robots. And we saw how we can use geometry to help us develop those frames. Although, by the way, some might argue that what I did here wasn't really geometrical. I effectively applied transformations. You are right, but then you could say that we had the aid or the visual aid to help us along. Nevertheless, the result is the same. Whether I use trigonometry or transformations will result in the same robot matrix that you see here. You could have argued that from the very beginning, we could have seen that this is X and this is Y. This is X and this is Y. But then grammar or geometrically speaking, we will also would be difficult to find this. We could always have argued that since it's a planar robot, so there will be only one rotation allowed, which is rotated about Z. And the total rotation will be the summation of these two angles, which is again what we see here. Again, same discussion, whether it was geometrical or matrix operations, the result is the same and allows you to see that they actually correspond to the same answer in the end. We also expanded that discussion to three-dimensional or 3DOF planar robot, and we saw how basically the analysis are essentially just an extension of the two-dimensional the 2DOF robot by simply adding one more frame to it. So we then talked briefly about the DH method or the Dinnegard-Hartenberg method, which is usually applied for complex robots or customized robots. And we did not dwell in depth into it. We did not perform it. We just talked briefly about it. And because it's not part of the syllabus of this course, however, For those watching YouTube, I will be making a separate video only on the DH method, for but that will be in a later time. And then once we develop the metrics for our robot, once the robot metrics is available, then it's just a matter of substitution. We saw that, for example, the Cartesian robot is straightforward. I mean, the robot parameters is exactly the robot values. Or, you know, the PX, view opposite, or the positions of the end effector is exactly the same as robot parameters, which is X, Y, Z as well. So that's why when it comes to the Cartesian robot, forward and inverse, by the way, will be straightforward, as you can see from here. Cylindrical equation, or the cylindrical robot, again, once the robot matrix is developed, then we have this lovely set of equation. Then we simply apply the principles of forward kinematics, just given the robot, given the values of robot parameters, in this case, the reach, the height, and the twist, then you can plug into these equations and calculate the corresponding position of the end effector, as well as the orientation, should we, if we needed that as well. Same thing applied for the spherical, the 2DOF robot, and the 3DOF robot, and just about any robot that we have to work with. As long as the robot matrix is available to you, whether it's developed by you or others, then it's just a matter of essentially getting the corresponding functions out of the matrix, plugging in the values, and then calculating the required position and orientation of the end effector. And we solved some examples, and I left some exercises from last week, and then that was what we did in the last session. So today we are now ready to talk about the inverse kinematics. And you will see that the inverse kinematics operation is the most significant part, or the most significant operation when it comes to industrial robots. A little bit of preparation. What we're going to talk about today essentially is the inverse kinematics equation, which we'll be talk about or introduce today. And then we will perform inverse kinematics using three different methods, algebraic, geometrical, and then decoupling. So let's begin with the session. So inverse kinematics, as we introduced earlier in earlier chapters, or in the theoretical or the introductory chapters, basically is the reverse or the inverse of the forward kinematics. Meaning, in this sense, if you are given the pose of the end effector, in other words, the position and orientation of the end effector, x, y, z, as well as the orientation, you will then be required to find the corresponding angles. In this case, as you can see in this diagram, let me go to full screen. No, not here. Okay, the full screen went to the other monitor. So let's do it again. Yeah, okay. So given the pose of the end effector, meaning the position and orientation of the end effector, then you would need, then you will inverse kinematics will again give us the corresponding values of theta 3, theta 2, and theta 1, that will then allow us to perform or to achieve this pose. In other words, in order for us to achieve this particular pose, you know, this x and y pose, we can then we need to find those corresponding values of the robot parameters. Visually speaking, what would that look like? Let me just switch on. Yeah, my marker. So if we come back to here, and then let me just change that to a pen. So right here, this is the frame of the end effector. Let's call it the frame right there. And this will be x, and this will be y. And why? Because usually this right here, this is n. For normal, and this is y for orientation, and the approach will be coming out from here. So essentially, this is this particular position of the frame and the orientation. In order for us to achieve it, which is, in other words, the word pose you see here, corresponds to the position and orientation. In other words, the frame really of here. In order to achieve this frame, we need to find the corresponding values for theta 3, theta 2, and theta 1. So that's how it works. So for example, if I give you, if let's say we ignore for a second, let's just ignore the orientation part. Let's just focus only on an XY, because this is a two-dimensional example. Let's just say that we are interested only in position. We are ignoring the orientation for a second. So giving the value for Y, and of course the value for X, which is all of this right here. If I give you these values, then we would like to find the values for the robot parameters to achieve this position. For a second, let's just ignore the orientation for a minute. So a robot or inverse kinematics simply gives us or gives us the procedures required to achieve this. Meaning, giving the values for x and y, it will then give us the values, the corresponding values for theta 1, theta 2, theta 3. Now, if we were talking about numerical procedures, then yes, we will get the exact values like 30, 120, and so on. But if you want to do it in symbolic, then we will get an equation or a formula that will actually help us achieve or find those value for any value of x, y, z. So that's essentially whether we want to do it numerically or we want to do it using variables or equations, both apply to inverse kinematics. Now, in order for us to do that, last time when we worked with forward kinematics, all we needed was the robot matrix. Once the robot matrix was ready, then we were able to pick up the, find the equations we needed. For example, if I go back to the forward kinematic slides and I just point your attention to, for example, to, let's just move on. Yeah, to here, for example. Yeah. See, for the spherical robot, for example, as soon as we had the, let me just open up the slides. Yeah. So as soon as we had the robot matrix ready, right, if you remember from the from last session, then essentially all we had to do was to pick up the, recognize that this particular part of the matrix is essentially SPX. And therefore, we were able to essentially to do this. And of course, PY, PZ, and the rest of the matrix like that. So we were ready to use that. Then, given the value that the parameters are provided or given, to just plug in the values. That was the lovely thing in robot kinematics. But in inverse kinematics, we don't have that luxury. You see, in inverse kinematics, let's go back. Yeah, in inverse kinematics, yes, we before we can begin the inverse kinematics, we still need the robot matrix. So that's the very same thing. That's also the requirement that we had with forward kinematics. We needed to have the robot matrix ready and before we can pick up the equations. In inverse kinematics, we also need the robot matrix, but we still need to do an extra step. What is that extra step? Well, we need to develop what is called the inverse kinematics equations. Unfortunately, once we have the robot matrix, like we did last week, right, and last time around, those equations are the forward kinematics equations. Because you see, given the robot parameters, then find the value, the positions of the end effector, of, you know, the position and orientation, of course, which is you see over here. But these are the forward, these are the equations in the forward direction. What we need is the other way around. You see, what does that mean by forward direction? Meaning that given the values of the robot parameters, in this case, theta I and li, we can then find the position and orientation of the robot. But then in inverse kinematics, we need the opposite. What we need is something that looks like this. We need a set of equations that basically give us the robot parameters. Meaning, these are now the robot parameters, right? And then what we have available information to us is the position, right, of the end effector, right? And let's just call the rest of the other the information that we have is other information. What other information? Let's just go down to the end. This is the definition of what did I mean by other information. Perhaps we could have the orientation information, the links, right? And parameters that already found. What does that mean? Meaning, for example, if let's say in the very first line, I found theta 1, so this theta 1 can be used in the next line to find theta 2, and also can be used in the next line, in the next equation, and so on. Meaning, whatever variables you already have found can also be used in other variables as well. It's like sort of building from one step at a time. So that's why, to simplify this whole process, that's why I called it other information. So you would need to have, of course, at the very beginning, you would need to have the position of the end effector. That's the starting point, which is the x, y, and z. But you also need to have, you might need to have other information as well. Other information could be the orientation of the end effector, the lengths, as well as the parameters that you already found. But then once you do have these equations ready, then once again, the job is done. Once you have the equations in the inverse direction, then the robot parameters can then be found given the position of the end effector as well as the other information. All right? So which among, I mean, if we compare between inverse kinematics and robot and forward kinematics, which one is the more significant? As you will see in the industry, you will see that the inverse problem is the more significant one and the most widely in use. And I'm going to give you an example right now. Let's just take a look at this robot. This robot right here, we would like it to move along this particular path. You see the path in red? And this path right here, it could be anything. It could be a pick-and-place path, could be a welding robot. I know it's a pick-and-place robot right now, but let's just imagine that this is a welding gun. So this could be the welding path. It could be anything. But we want the robot to travel in this particular path. Ignore the velocities and acceleration for now. Let's just say what is more important to us that the robot travels from here along this line and passes through all of these points from point 1 to point 13. As you see, point 1 to point 13. And this path is actually defined by us. It could be whatever we want. The path that basically I'm the designer, I'm the the operator, and I want the robot to travel from here to here. Excuse me, not from here to here, but along this particular path. And this particular path can be defined using these points, points 1 through 13. And each one of these points is also defined by a corresponding coordinates. You can see point 1 has a set of coordinates, px1, py1, and pz1, means position x1, position or point x1, point y1, and z1, and so on. So every one of these points, as you can see, are actually are given. And the requirement here is that we want the robot to travel along every one of these points. This is the requirement. These would be the coordinates of the end effector along the path. Now, in general, we also could include the orientation, but once again, not just for now, ignore the orientation. You see, in this particular example, on this particular robot, we don't care about the orientation because it's fixed in this particular orientation. But maybe if we have other complicated robots, we might have the orientation might change. So in that case, it could also be provided as well. But for now, let's just ignore the orientation for a second. Let's just agree that, we have this set of coordinates and I want my robot to travel along these points, okay? Now, the challenge here is that the controller, this right here, we will have a motor. This will be a motor to turn and this will be a motor here. And maybe we'll have a linear actuator to go up and down. We're going to ignore the gripper itself, and it's not part of the motion. The gripper itself just open and close. We're just going to focus only on the manipulator part. So you see we have one joint here, and then one joint here, and one other joint here for the rotation, and then we have a linear motion right here. M3 basically just goes up and down. So we have all of these actuators, and these actuators obviously will be controlled by a controller, microcontroller. And that microcontroller would need to be programmed by the developer, right, or the programmer or the system, right? And the program must tell it how much is the individual joint movement, like how much to rotate here, how much to rotate for M2, how much to rotate for M3, and so on and so forth. The thing is, the robot controller does not understand these values because these are the positions of the end effector. These are actually X, Y, Z coordinates. What the robot controller understands is the robot parameters. In other words, theta I. Now, when I wrote the slides, I forgot that this is a linear joint right here. So if you want to be general, you can say theta I and Li. So maybe Li should be added here. Li meaning if one of the joints is linear, so L will not be constant. So again, you'll have a linear actuator there. But the idea is the same. You see, the robot does not control X, Y, Z coordinates. It controls robot parameters. But the problem is, I don't have this robot parameters. I only have X, Y, Z coordinates. And that is why we need to find the corresponding values of the joint parameters. What does that mean? You see, in order to get to this position, the first point right here, I need to find the corresponding values for theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, and A4. A, and in this case, is the length, yeah, which is the last, the linear joint. You got me? In other words, this values right here, as you can see, the values for the first row, yeah, the values for theta 1, theta 2, and L, right? These four values correspond to this position. So in order for the robot to go to this position, I'll have to feed these values to the controller. I have to tell it, you know what, these are the corresponding values that will result in the end effector being at this location. And the same thing happened in every one of these points. Again, so in order for us to allow the robot to travel from this path, I need to feed it this set of values. This set of values in the correct sequence. Basically, these values first, and after an interval of time, this set of values, and after an interval of time, these values, and so on until the end of the table. If I do so, and using a certain delay between every coordinates, this will result in the robot first coming up here, then moving to the second point, then moving to the second point, and so on until the last point, which is essentially what we wanted all along. We wanted the robot to travel along this path from the beginning point until the last point. So in order for us to solve this puzzle, we need this set of values, which is theta I and li, which is I forgot to put here. So again, li here. Well, how do we get those values? Well, that's where inverse kinematics come in. You see, inverse kinematics does exactly that, as we said earlier, giving the positions of the robot and other information, we can then find the corresponding robot parameters. And this could be, once again, in the form of values, like as you can see in this table, or simply in a form of functions. And those functions will be in terms or will be function of those values. So once you develop the functions, then whatever values you have, you can just plug in and find the corresponding values. So this is now the significance of inverse kinematics. Inverse kinematics allows us to do complicated robot operations, such as a specific path, traveling along a complicated path, or you know, avoiding obstacles along a certain path, pick and place, and so on and so forth. Forward kinematics is usually used a lot less when it comes to inverse kinematics. So let's return to this slide that we saw before. So in order for us to do inverse kinematics, we first need to develop the equations, the inverse kinematics equations. You see, the robot matrix, it was helpful for forward operations, but it does not help us in inverse. We need to use it to develop the inverse kinematics equations. Okay, and then once we have those equations, which you can see a general look into them right here, once we have those equations, then we can then plug in the values, plug in X, Y, and Z, and the other information, then we can find the corresponding values for those guys right here. And once that is available to us, then we can then do whatever the robot wants. Is that clear? And if you remember what I told you last time in the beginning of the semester, we said that we need to use kinematics in order to develop control equations. This is exactly what the control equations are. The control equations are the equations that will be fed into the controller, which is it then can be used to control robot parameters. And this is exactly what we were talking about. In order for the controller to control this joint, for example, and this joint, right? We need to tell it how much is the values. Well, those actually are dependent on the equations that we're going to develop right here. Itself, those equations will take the required position and orientation of the path, and then that will then result in the robot motion that we want to achieve. I hope this whole journey made sense. See, the starting point is that this is the path that we wanted the robot to travel on. The path can be defined or found using geometry or algebra or whatever. Then we can find the corresponding X, Y, and Z for every point along the path. Then through inverse kinematics, we can find the corresponding values or equations to develop those values. We can then take those values and we can put it in the robot controller, allowing it to travel from one point to the next, then achieving the robot motion that we want to achieve. Okay, so now how do we develop those equations? Well, we have, again, several approaches: algebraic, geometrical, and decoupling. You might be familiar with algebraic, or the meaning of the word algebraic or algebra. Definitely you're familiar with the word geometrical, but this is definitely a new concept, which we will talk about in detail in a while. But let's just talk about the easy stuff first. So let's talk about inverse kinematics. I think this should be equations, but it's fine. And now we talk about algebraic methods. So we're going to use the algebraic methods on the standard robots. I hope by now you know why they are called standard robots. See, once again, the Cartesian robot is pretty much straightforward because the values of the position of the end, it doesn't have any orientation, so we can ignore it. But then the value of the position of the end defector are exactly the same values of the robot parameters. So there is no confirmation, there is no confusion here. If you're looking for how much the robot parameter, basically it's exactly the same values that the controller accepts, which is XYZ values. So just simply tell me what's the position you want, what is the sequence of position you want, and then we're good to go. Or if you want, if you go back to this table, you can see that in the Cartesian robot, you will have here again, X and Y and Z, but these will be the robot parameters, you get what I mean? Rather than positions. So what's the value for position you want? Okay, what will be the corresponding value for X, Y, Z, and so on and so forth. So again, let's move on because it's the easiest one. So now we move on to a little bit of work, which is the inverse kinematics for cylindrical. We have seen it before, we have done it last week, and we have developed this set of equations. And these are the forward kinematics equation. Now, once again, this situation requires the fact that R, which is the reach, alpha, which is the twist, and L, which is the height, are all given. Once these values are given, we just plug in here, and then that will correspond to Px, Py, Pz, as you can see from here. But today, what we want to do is the opposite. We don't have the value for L, alpha, or R. In fact, we would like to find them. What is given to us, on the other hand, is the opposite, which is X, Y, Z, and maybe other information. So using these equations as a starting point, using the forward kinematics as a starting point, let's try to solve and find the other way around. Meaning, in other words, if X was given, if X, Y, and Z were given in this time, can I find the other way around or those values using algebra? I think you can. In fact, I'll give you a couple. Let me clean up a little bit here, this slide. So once again, if given the values, now, last week when we solved this, R and alpha and L were given. So that was pretty much straightforward. But then this time around, if X, Y, Z were given, can we solve and find R, alpha, and L? Definitely we can. And I'm going to give you a moment to think about it. So pause this video right now and spend some time to think about whether you can use algebra basically to develop the equations for R, alpha, and L. Okay, so I hope you've done it. And if you've done it correctly, then you should get this set of equations. Obviously, we will start with the easier one and the one that is readily available to us, which is right here. L is equal to Z, which is exactly the same equation you see here. So what I wrote here was simply just to say that we have the first function, that L is simply equal to Z. So if you know the corresponding Z value for the X effector, it would be exactly the same value for L. Okay, what's next? Alpha, which is the twist angle, essentially is inverse tangent of X divided by Py divided by Px. How did this come around? I'll let you to think more about it, but then I'm going to write it here. And then the last equation, which is essentially the third function, this is basically saying that the second function, third function, which is essentially py over c alpha or cosine alpha. You could have done it using y, but basically there's another equation for here if you want, using the sine. We could have said that this is going to be py divided by s alpha, which is also correct. So how does that work? Well, essentially you can see that if let's say this was equation number one, and this was equation number two. Well, all you really have to do is divide equations 2 divided over 1. So that would result in R S alpha divided by R C alpha. On the other side, we're going to get P Y divided by P X. Is that right? R and R will cancel. This now is equal to tangent alpha. Is that right? And then this is P Y P X given values. So from here on in, we can just get alpha is equal to inverse tangent, which what you see here. And now that alpha is available to us, we can, and L of course is available to us, we can then use either equation one or equation two to solve for R, which is what we did here. This is equation number one and this is equation number two. Okay, and this is what I meant by algebra. So now that the algebraic equations are basically, now we have used algebra to develop inverse equations for the cylindrical robots. Now, what we can do now, we can actually solve any reverse or inverse problem for this particular robot. Meaning, if you would like the robot to travel along a certain path and you have a set of coordinates all you really have to do is just plug into those set of equations right here, and that will give you the corresponding set of robot parameters. This kind of look again. If you have these coordinates, but now we are dealing with a cylindrical robot, just plug in the equation and you will get the corresponding R, alpha, and L using the equations. So you will have the corresponding L. L, of course, will equal to Z, which is this value right here, but R and alpha will be found corresponding from those values. Alpha will be simply this value divided by this value, inverse tangent, and then R can be found from one of the other two equations that we found before. I hope this makes sense. Now, if this is easy, of course it's easy, because that's why we are dealing with, that's why we call those robots standard, because working with them is relatively easy. And if you remember from last week, that easiness or that easy part slowly will fade away and things will become a little bit complex. So let's carry on. So now we talk about the next robot, which is spherical. And once again, this is what we did last week or last session. We developed the robot matrix. Where is my cursor? Disappeared. Oh, okay. So essentially, we developed the robot matrix, and then we use this to find the forward equations. Once again, we can use algebra for this. The reason why we can use, I mean, the reason why we can reuse this is because we have 1, 2, and 3 variables to find this, and we are lucky that we have cosine and sine in the equations. And this is what will happen here. We also have, actually, some people might argue that this is not 2 variables, but more. This 1 variable, and 2 variable, and 3 variables. Some people might argue that this is actually a variable, and this is the variable. But if you treat it that way, then this will not become, will become unsolvable. But if you treat it with cosine alpha and sine alpha, then it is solvable as we saw. The same thing here. If you consider these are actually 3 variables, which is in this case, the reach and the base angle and the twist angle. I forgot what this the name of this angle was. Beta and gamma. And we have to go. I have to go back to those other slides from forward chemistry to remember their names. But once again, these are the robot parameters. And once again, you can also use algebra to solve for this, meaning giving the values for x and y and z. Try to manipulate those equations to develop 3 sets of functions for beta, gamma, and the R for the spherical robot. Once again, I'll give you a moment to think about it and then try to develop it on your own. So pause this video right now and think about it for a minute before we can proceed. Okay, so once again, here is the set of equations that you should have found easily. So once again, this is now gamma, the first equation, which is essentially tan inverse y divided by x. And beta will be tan inverse y divided by this values. And notice how gamma is used here to find beta. That's what I meant by once you have one parameter, then you can use it to find another parameter. See, by the way, we also did that here, right? And when we, once we found alpha, we can then use it to find R, and then definitely the same thing here. Once we find gamma, then we can just plug it into the equation along with y and z, the values, and then we can find beta. And then once we have basically beta, then you can actually find the reach. How does this work? Again, once again, you started from those forward equations. If this is number 1, and this is number 2, and this is 3. And again, you can notice that RSB or R sine beta is common between 1 and 2. So if we divide those equations, they will cancel. So once again, equation 2 divided by equation 1 will give us sine gamma divided by cosine gamma, which is tangent gamma, right? And the other side will get y divided by x. So that will result in tangent of gamma. Then we can solve easily for gamma. And then once gamma is solved or available, you can then use these equations. Again, if you come here, equation 2 and 3, right? You can notice that if we divide equation 2 over equation 3, we're going to get, we're going to get tangent beta multiplied by S gamma. R and R will cancel, then multiplied by Py divided by Pz. Is that right? There is R, but the R goes away, and then gamma we already have from the first equation. We can put it on the other side here, sine gamma, and that's what you see here, and then we can get inverse tangent. And of course, once you have beta and gamma, you can then go to the last equation if you want, equation 3, and find R. Of course, you could have found it from equations 1 and 2, but then equation 3 is the easiest, so that's why we go to equation 3. So this is, again, another example of using algebra, and usually algebra is easily worked with because we have linear values. You see, in a cylindrical robot, we had two linear values, R and L, so the equations were relatively simple. But then as we add more orientation, things become a little bit more complex, as you can see from here. This is what's still doable with algebra, but then we need to do a little bit more work. Now, if you have developed the equations for Euler, last week when we talked about Euler and RPY, if you remember those, RPY is rotate about XYZ, or ZYX, and then Euler is YZY. I actually don't remember the exact order, but then these are three rotations in three different planes. Is that right? So if you have developed those matrices and you would have seen a very complicated equation, then you would, if you had developed those equations, then you would realize that using algebra will not be possible. Doing things like what we did here actually will not be possible. In fact, I'm gonna try, I did not actually develop the equations myself, but I'm gonna try to find those matrices online, and then I'm gonna show you what I'm talking about. So RPY matrix, and I hope I can find the actual matrix itself. Ah, yes, this is a lovely example. Let me show you how I found it. Basically, I just Googled RPY matrix, and you will see this lovely example right at the top. You click on it, and you will find this is essentially the operation. You see, this is rotate about Z, rotate about Y, and rotate about Z, rotate about Y, and rotate about X. And as you can see, this is rotate about Z template. Notice that they are ignoring the rest of the matrix. They don't put position and in the bottom frame. That's fine. If you're dealing with pure rotations only, that's fine. And then this is rotate about Y, and then this is rotate about X. And then once you multiply everything, as you can see from here, this is the RPY, yeah? Alpha, beta, and gamma, right, which is rotate about Z, and they are in this order because they are essentially about the local frames, yeah. So then you can get this matrix. And this is what I wanted to show you in the end. You see here, right here, this particular part, let's ignore the rest of the matrix, but it focus on this part right here. You can clearly see that this whole thing right here is equal to, I cannot write on this page, this is not PowerPoint, but you know what I can do? I can try to, yeah, copy the image, and let's now move to back to my slides. And we were here. And let me insert a new slide and then try to paste that picture there. And then here and V. Yep, it came here. That's lovely. And let me actually also zoom in a little bit. No, let's not zoom in. That's good enough. And now we go to full view. Okay, so now we see this is the matrix of RPY matrix. And now we can see that this particular element right here essentially is PX. Is that right? Even if I, and also this is PY, and this is PZ. And you can see from the equation, let me try to rewrite it again. So this is PX is equal to C alpha S, this again. Okay, so let's try and do this again. Yeah, so here we have S beta, and then we have C gamma plus sine alpha and sine gamma. This is all one equation, yeah? And you can see there are three variables here, alpha, beta, and gamma, and they're all jumbled together. It's impossible for you to isolate to do something like, you know, what we did for the cylindrical and the spherical robot. And similarly for the PY and the PZ. I'm not gonna write the whole thing now. We can see now how the matrix now is too jumbled. These equations now are called nonlinear equations because they involve angles or cosines and sines. They basically now involve trigonometry. What is it called? Trigonometry, okay? In some countries it's called trigonometry, some other countries called trigonometry. I'm going to try to edit this part out, but otherwise, let's enjoy the laugh. But then, trigonometry or trigonometry, right, essentially makes it difficult for you to do algebraic operations. It's impossible for you to solve or isolate functions for beta and gamma, as you can see from here. It will be very, very much near impossible. Actually, it is impossible to use algebra to solve for this. So there will be no way for you to develop equations that actually solve for these angles. That is why we will actually apply the principle of decoupling, but that will be later today. For now, when it comes to complicated matrices like this, that will be not possible to use algebra. Trigonometry. Okay, now I get it. Trigonometry. Okay, so it's fine. So now exercise time. So now basically this is our first exercise, and in this particular example, let's spend some time to recap and put information into perspective. So this particular example gives you the name of the robot. Given the position of the end effector of a cylindrical robot, which is equal to Px, Py, and Pz values given here, find the corresponding robot parameters. And that's it. It does not say another word. So given this information that you have in this example, find the values, yeah? I think what they meant is find the values of the robot parameters, yeah? So find the values of the robot parameters. So you are given the name of the robot, so find the values of the robot parameters, okay? Of the robot parameters. Okay, so given the position and end effector of the cylindrical robot, as you can see here, negative 8, 4.5, and z equal to 4, find the values of the robot parameters needed to reach this position. Once again, I'll give you a moment to think about this, or you can just pause the video right now and then spend some time solving this. You might want to go back to that earlier slide to use the equations or from the cylindrical robot. Or if you have the notes from our robot forward kinematics equation, you will have it there. Or if, in fact, I'm going to write it for you right here. For the cylindrical robot, we developed that Px is equal to R cosine alpha. And we said that Pz is equal to R sine alpha. And that was Py. And then Pz is here is initially equal to L. So now, giving the values for X, Y, and Z, find the corresponding robot parameters. Okay, notice how one couple of things. First of all, these equations were not given to you in the question itself. It was just given the name. The name of the robot was given. So you were required to recall those equations yourself. You don't have to memorize it. If you have written it somewhere, we just Google it, whatever. But then you have to find out, essentially, that these are the equations that we're going to start with. Then, essentially, repeat the process that we did in the exercise earlier when we reversed the equations. And then develop the formulas that we developed for cylindrical. And then, what is it? Yeah, right here. And then plug in the values. So that's exactly what we're going to need to do for this exercise. For the cylindrical robot, okay, the robot is given to us as cylindrical. So we're going to use its inverse equation directly. Now, you didn't have to repeat the process of developing the equations. But if you forgot what the equations look like, you can just quickly redevelop them from the forward equations. But if you do remember them, then the equations are right here. So L is equal to Z, that's already settled. And alpha is simply equal to tan inverse X, Y over X, as you can see from here. And then A tan 2 is inverse, obviously using the values. And if you actually using your calculator right now and you plugged in your calculator this value right here, which is 4.5, and you found something else, that something else is not correct. The value of the angle must be this value right here, which is 151 degrees and not the other value that you have found in your calculator. Why is that? I'll let this part for you to think about for a minute while I basically move on with the example. So once you find the value for alpha, and then you can actually use it to find the value for R. Hopefully you will see why the significance of the value for alpha is important. If you find the wrong value for alpha, then the value for R will also be wrong, resulting in two wrong values, resulting in you losing a lot of marks in the question. So why this is the correct value and that why we're using A10 to not A10 is because if you put this number in the calculator, there will be no difference between, it will not recognize the difference between 4.5 divided by negative 8 or negative 4.5 divided by 8. For them, it's the same value. Essentially, it cannot tell the difference between the two. But in reality, there is a significant difference. We know that the tangent is sine over cosine. So if this is the sine, so this is 4.5 here, and negative 8 will be here. So the value is right here. So this is the line. So therefore, this is the corresponding angle. But if this was the one that you think about, so that would be negative 4.5 here, and then 8 will be here. Negative 0.5 will be here, and then 8 positive will be here, and then that will be the angle. Ignore this other line here. So you have two possible values. It's either this one or this one. So the calculator might give you this value, but you can never tell for sure. That is why you have to use A10-2. I'm not sure if your calculator supports it, or you need to learn how to adjust the values yourself by recognizing that this is positive and this is negative. Positive and negative means we are in the second quarter of the diagonal. I think I can Google this as well. Let me see. A10, what is that again? I think the article on Google is, on Wikipedia is clear. But no, it's essentially, let's just talk about 10 quarters, quadrants. Yeah, 10 quadrants. Yeah, I think the best for you to see this is the 10 quadrants. Just Google 10 quadrants, you'll find a primitive explanation and why the angle should be adjusted accordingly. And therefore, you need to know the difference between, need to know the importance of recognizing the quadrants. You get what I mean? So, and therefore, how to adjust the value for the tangent. And this is quite significant if you want to work with tangents. And we will work with tangent a lot using inverse kinematics. So, knowing how to, of course, if you're using the, Excel or programming like Python, whatever, you can easily use the A10-2 function. It also applies in Excel. But if you're using on your own calculator, then you need to adjust the value for tangent accordingly. You get what I mean? So, that's how you... I'll leave this part for you to figure it out about what does that 10 quadrant mean. And then you can then, let me try and find a good article. Maybe there's even videos about it. So that will help you to identify the best or the proper way to figure out the correct value for tangent. Okay, so let's not deviate from the topic of today's video. Maybe I'll find a link for some good point on this and then I'm going to add it in the description. So let's move on. So once you find the value for alpha, then you can actually find the value for r. We're good to go. Another example is similar, but now for the spherical robot. Now hopefully you get the idea. So knowing this for the name of the robot, then you know its equations, then just plug in and solve. And once again, you now have two tangents to deal with. So then you need to, now you hopefully you will see the significance of learning or at least refreshing your memory about the tangent. For example, this is in the first quadrant. So whatever value you plug in the equation will be correct. But then if you had negative and negative, and you put negative 4.5 divided by negative 1.94, the negatives will cancel, and the calculator will still give you 67, which is incorrect, because if they were negatives, then it will be actually the other way around. If this was the positive value, but actually if they were both negative, then this will be the correct value, and the angle will be all of this. So I think, if I recall correctly from my school days, this is essentially what we used to call right now. Last time, this is 10 directly, 10 theta, whatever you get from the calculator. And this is 10 minus 180. And this is 10 plus 180. And this is 10 negative 10 or minus 360, if I recall correctly. So this is 180. I mean, the way to adjust the value from the calculator. So you're going to get, this is the value directly. If you plug in the value in the calculator, this will be the same value, but this one you'll have to take the calculator will give you this number, but then we need the other way around. So it's 180 minus this number. And if you are here, then the calculator will give you this value, but you need to add 180 to it. And so on. I actually don't remember it, but I'll leave it for you again to double check the adjustments that you have to do if you're doing it by hand. Otherwise, I suggest that you do or use 8 and 2. If your calculator supports 8 and 2, that'll be even easier. But I also suggest that you learn the science behind it or the math behind it, and then so that you know what's going on behind the scenes. Okay, let's move on. So that was this is an interesting example. Let's take a look at this example right here. Company X wished to upgrade its robotic welder. The robot welder that they had in the beginning was a cylindrical robot. Why would anyone use a cylindrical robot as a welder? It's beyond me, but let's just ignore that for a minute. So let's just call it the pick and place, okay? So originally they had a cylindrical robot, and the robot parameters, as you can see, is R is equal to 5. This is an L, yeah, not 1, yeah? L is equal to 7, and alpha is equal to 25 degrees. So according to them, these are the robot parameters, 5, L, and alpha is equal to 25%. However, they would like to change their robot from cylindrical to spherical, as you can see here. So if they want to change the robot from cylindrical to spherical, then what will be the corresponding robot parameters needed to achieve the same performance? In other words, I already have the robot parameters from cylindrical. I would like to find the corresponding parameters, but in spherical. If you remember, in spherical, the parameters look different. We have beta and gamma, or at least two angles, and then we have another R. This R will be designated RSPH for spherical. Is that right? So obviously, in order for us to find to switch to spherical and use and update or maintain the same performance, we need to find the corresponding values for robot parameters in a spherical that will actually achieve this. So think about it. Again, pause the video, think about it, into how you can solve this. Or take your time while I clean this up, and then we will do it together. So again, once again, the question is saying that they have a cylindrical robot and they would like to switch to a spherical robot. How, and while maintaining the same performance, basically reaching the same point or whatever, right? And then how do they actually do that? What would be the new robot parameters to achieve the same target? Okay, done. Let's see it. So first of all, in a cylindrical, the idea behind this, first of all, is that, let's just visualize this. So here we have a cylindrical robot. Let me just quickly do this. So here we have the cylindrical robot, and here is this, and this is the arm, and this is the arm is extendable, and here is the gripper. So you have here one joint, and then this is extending, and also this is extending, and then we reach this point. So this right here is 7, right? And this right here is 5, and the angle itself that we turned is equal to 25 degrees. And this right here corresponds to a position which is, let's call it X, Y, and Z. We don't know the values yet, but it comes to this point. Is that right? Now, what the company wants to do is that they want to change the robot to something else. And that robot essentially is a spherical robot. So the spherical robot, let's just say that it looks now. Wait, that was an ugly drawing. Let me fix that. Yeah. So the spherical robot now have two joints. I know that in a real spherical robot, they don't look like this, but just bear with me for a minute. So this is now beta. And this is now gamma, and then it needs to extend all the way until it gets to the same point. That's what they meant by same performance. I mean, it reaches the same point. So the last link right here, we had the reach, so that will be RSPH. Okay, so what we have here is that we have this red robot that reaches the same point here, and then after we change to this blue robot, we would like to find those corresponding values that can achieve the same point. So how do we do that? Hopefully with the visualization of the problem now, hopefully you can actually get the idea. So once again, I'll give you a moment to think about it, and then we can try and do it together. Okay, I hope you have figured it out. So the plan is simple. You see, we already have the robot parameters here. So we already have alpha and L and R. So what we can do is that using these robot parameters, you can then find the corresponding position and end of the end effector. In other words, we can do forward kinematics here. So we could, in order for us to make sure that the spherical robot can achieve the same performance, we would have to find this actual position. How much is X, Y, and Z? So given the fact that we have a cylindrical robot and we have the values, so we can simply straight away can say X is simply equal to R cosine alpha. And R and alpha are given. And the same thing for Y, R sine alpha. And then Z is obviously, is L is given. So then from these values, we can from these equations, I mean, we can then find the corresponding X and Y and Z, okay? So this is right here, step number one in cylindrical robot, okay? So now that we have done this part, now we look at the cylindrical robot example. Now we have the position of the end effector, but we need to find the corresponding robot parameter, the parameters. This looks like an inverse kinematics equation, and we have the equations for spherical. So now we need to find the equations for B, beta, and gamma, as well as R for spherical. And the equations for that we have already developed. If I'm not mistaken, this is A tan 2 Y over Z. It's either that or gamma, I don't know which one, don't memorize it. Sorry, it's gamma, yeah. So this was gamma, and this was beta. And here was A tan 2 for memory, I don't remember it. But then you get to my point. Once you get the equations back, right, from spherical, yeah, these are the equations. So A tan 2, PY over PZ, and then sine gamma, and then we can solve for R spherical here. So the idea is that once you've found the position, then you can, so here we did forward kinematics in order to find the corresponding end effector. Then over here we did inverse kinematics to find the new robot parameters, which is the robot parameters for the spherical. And this way we were able to convert from this robot parameters to the second robot parameters. And this is what is called the conversion equation. Now we could have written this question in reverse, meaningly. We could have started with a spherical and we want to convert into a cylindrical. And of course the parameters will be alpha, beta, and R spherical. We'd like to find the corresponding for cylindrical. That also could have been possible, and the procedure is very, very similar. We start with forward kinematics in one robot to find the position of the end effector, and then we use it to find the parameters of the next robot using inverse kinematics. Of course, we could have used other robots as well, not necessarily just spherical and cylindrical. We could have used 2DOF planar robot and 3DOF planar robot, and so on and so forth. But the idea is the same thing. You go forward once, and then you go inverse one and second, and in order to convert from one robot to another. And here are the steps. In the cylindrical robot, we apply forward kinematics to find PX, PY, PZ. Let me change the color of the pen. And then because we started with a cylindrical robot, then we basically start with forward kinematics and we find PX, PY, PZ. And here we are. Then we take those values, X, Y, and Z, and we apply spherical robot inverse kinematics on them. And then we can just simply plug into those equations, giving us the values that we have here. And then these will be the new robot parameters. So you see, this is now the first robot parameters, which was for cylindrical. And now these are the new robot parameters for spherical. And both of them achieve the same target, which means what actually? Meaning achieving the same position of the end effector. Is that clear? Okay, so we can take a break now. It's almost... how long we've been going? It's nearly 1 hour. Yeah, it's perfect. If you are in the class, from the class with me, then this would be break time. Otherwise, if you are on YouTube, it's been 1 hour. You can take a break or pause before I begin the next topic, which is geometrical methods to developing inverse kinematics. So once again, let's take a short break. You can pause and take a short break. And then let's come back and continue with visual or graphical methods. Okay, so let's continue now with geometrical methods. So the first method was to develop inverse kinematics using algebra. Now we're going to use geometry. And this method obviously requires the fact that you already have a drawing of the robot available to you, either available already or you have the skills or the abilities to draw it yourself. So let's take a look at our 2DOF planar robot, the one we worked with in a forward kinematics slide. And once again, our objective right now is to find a formula or a set of formulas to find the values for theta 1 and theta 2. And some of you will be thinking, oh, this is easy. We can easily use our geometry or trigonometry, right, to find the values. And rightly so. So let's do it. So maybe theta 1 is easy for you to think about, because theta 1 can easily be found from L1, right? See, if we just think about this triangle for a minute, imagine that this is a straight line here. So if this was L1, and obviously this would be, this is y1, and this is x1. So we can easily find the value for the angle. But what about this other situation here, where we have this triangle? Then we need to find this length, and we need to find this length. And that's why we need to take a look a little bit more at this situation. We're going to apply a little bit of trigonometry here. I practice this word now, trigonometry, to find the values for theta 1 and theta 2. So let's begin with the Pythagorean theory, which is r squared. Let's focus on this big triangle right here. R squared is equal to x squared and y squared. And x squared, and x basically is obviously x2, or the x position of the end effector, and y is the y position of the end effector. R is the diagonal line as well. Okay, so the same R from the smaller triangle that you see here can also be found from the cosine rule, or from the triangular cosine rule. Again, I'm not going to spend time to teach this cosine rule or rule, whatever. I suggest that you go and recap your trigonometry, but then hopefully you can verify that this equation is also true, that R squared is equal to L1 squared plus L2 squared plus 2L1, L2 cosine, the angle between them, which is, happens to be alpha. We're going to define a new angle. We're going to call it alpha for now. Temporarily, we're going to call it alpha. Okay, and then if we rearrange this line here, you're going to get this lovely equation for cosine alpha, which is all of this. L1, L2, R squared, and 2L1. Okay, and substituting the value for R, remember that we, in the beginning, we started with this, that R2 is equal to x squared plus y squared. Is that right? Then we put that equation here, and we get this part right here. Is that right? Now, if you think about this particular equation here, although it's a bit lengthy, but basically everything here is available to you. This x and this y are essentially are the x and y coordinates of the end effector. They are available to you. And L1 and L2 are the length of each link, which are constant and definitely available. If not, you can just simply measure them. And then you have the values. So once you have those values, all of them, you can quickly find alpha. Okay. Well, since theta 2 is 180 minus alpha from single trigonometry as well, therefore, then cosine theta 2 is simply equal to negative cosine alpha. This is the properties of this relationship here, okay? So therefore, we can simply, what does that mean? Once again, if theta 2 is, since theta 2 is equal to 180 minus alpha, then cosine theta 2 is negative cosine alpha. But cosine alpha is available to us. We have this long equation here. Is that right? So therefore, cosine theta 2 is simply the reverse of that by simply putting negative into all of that. And that's where, or that's how, we get this lovely equation right here. Let me just clean this up. And this is the first equation. Think about it now. This is now an inverse kinematics equation. Why? Because it involves the position and orientation of the end effector plus other information. You know what I mean? And basically now we can then use it to directly find theta 2. Once you, obviously inverse, get theta 2, inverse cosine or a cos. Oh, and so basically now that's essentially the first equation for the 2D OF a planar robot. If you missed it, you can rewind this couple of minutes and see how we did it. But then we simply applied the trigonometry. The first rule was the Pythagorean rule right here, which is R squared, X squared, plus Y squared. Then we applied the cosine rule on this other triangle. Then we then manipulated the equations and then recognized that alpha and theta 2 are related, are on the same line. So we have this relationship between us. Then from then on, we can then use to find cosine theta 2. and also then recognize that this is the first equation that we're going to use to find theta 2. Okay, let's carry on. What about theta 1? Well, let's just now continue. Now let's just focus on this other triangle. Let's just focus on the fact that we have, at this point, we're going to consider theta 2 as available. Available means is now, remember when I told you that we will use x and y coordinates of the end effector plus other information. Now that we have found theta 2, this is now also part of the other information. It's available to us for us to use to find theta 1. So now let's take a look at this other triangle, the smaller triangle right here. And now we have L2 cosine theta 2 and L2 sine theta 2. Is that clear? The angle is available to us, and L2 is definitely available to us, so therefore these two links are also available to us. Okay? Now let's take a look at this longer triangle, this long one over here. And focus on this yet another angle that we're going to define, which is beta. And now if you think about it, this angle can be found from inverse tangent of what? Of inverse tangent of this length right here, which is available to us, right? Divided by this length, is that right? And this length is also available to us because it's equal to L1, as you can see, plus this angle right here, and this length right here. And that's exactly what is shown here. So you can clearly see that A tan 2 means inverse tangent. That one I talked about just now when I was talking about the tangent quadrant. So consider this is already discussed. So beta, which is another new angle that we just defined, essentially is L2 S2 or L2 theta 2 and sine theta 2 divided by L1 plus L2 cosine theta 2. Is that clear? Okay, that's lovely, but then what does that do for us? Yet another triangle, or actually back to this big triangle again, and we're going to define yet another angle, which is now gamma. This whole thing is gamma. And gamma, obviously, in order for us to find it, essentially is A tan 2y, which is all of this, divided by x, which is essentially the positions of the end effector, py over px. So far, so good. So let's take a look at theta 1 now. We can realize that theta 1 essentially is gamma minus beta. Is that right? You can visually see it, that the corresponding value of theta 1 is actually gamma minus beta. And yes, here it is. And we have a formula for beta, we have a formula for gamma. So just simply add them all together. So eventually this whole thing, this is gamma right here, and this is beta. And that's basically a formula, although it's quite lengthy. But this lengthy equation is doable and essentially can be used to find theta 1. If you look at this equation, you will see that everything here is already available to you. Of course, y and x are available to you. L1 and L2 are available to you. And theta 1 is found from the first step. Step number 1 was to find theta 2. And that was here. We found theta 2. Now it's available to us to use to find theta 1. And that's exactly what we did here. And let's just recap. So these are the two equations side by side. So these are now the inverse equations for the 2DOF planar robots. Theta 2 is right here and theta 1 is right there. And these are the inverse kinematics equation for this robot. From now on, if you want to program or control this robot, then you can just simply take these equations and you plug them into the program, or excuse me, to the controller program that running or controlling this motion. All you need is to take those values. And if you provide it with a set of, let's say you have a path that you want to travel. Let's say you want this point right here at the end of the vector to travel along this path. No problem. All you need to find is the coordinates of these points, or simply develop or do what is called. There is another procedure rather than defining individual points like this. There is another procedure which we will learn next week. But for now, let's just assume that we have the coordinates of each point, and we provide a set of each point, and that will give you the motions you see. The values we see from here. So exercise time. Given the position of the end effector, as you can see from here, the 2DF robot, the values for X and Y and Z is given, and the length L1 and L2 is equal to five, then find the robot parameters. Once again, all you need to do is to take those equations. These are the inverse kinematics equations for the robot. First of all, you need to determine Are we talking about an inverse kinematics or a forward kinematics? Of course, since inverse is right here written, it's very clearly written. But what if this question was in a test or something and you need to determine, are we dealing with robot forward kinematics or inverse kinematics? So you need to look at what is the information given to you. So obviously what is given to you is the coordinates of the effector. And what is required of you to find is the robot parameters. So that's the very definition of the inverse kinematics problem. So therefore, you need to use the inverse kinematics equation. So either you use them directly from here, or since the question did not specify whether to develop or use the equations directly, so you can simply use the equations directly, plug in the values of x, y, z, and L1 and L2, and then you're good to go. So you start here first, or step number one. Because if you try to start here, it's impossible because this equation requires theta 2, which you don't have yet. So that is why you have to start here. Even though that this is theta 2, you have to start with it. It doesn't matter whether you find the last angle first. It doesn't matter as long as you find them all in the end. So here you have x, y, and L1 and L2, and all the values are available to you, given to you in the equation. Plug them all in, inverse cosine, and you'll find the values for theta. And once again, you plug in the values here and you find the corresponding value for theta 1. If you're thinking, sir, cosine have two possible values, plus or minus. Yes, that's correct. And that the corresponding values will look like this. That's an ugly drawing. So the corresponding solution, you will have two solutions for this problem. So this is the positive solution and this is the negative solution. But usually we can ignore one of them and use the, from now on, you can just ignore the negative solution and focus only on the positive solution. And here we go. So basically that's the value. Right here, basically we start with theta 2. And here's the value, a cosine value, plug in the values and you get the value. Now what we have here, actually in reality, you have plus minus 46. Because if you take negative 46.7 and you put in a cosine, you will get the same value again. So that's also correct. But we're going to ignore the negative values for now. I'm going to use the plus one and move on, and then we can solve as usual. Okay? And then we can then find the corresponding values for theta 1 and theta 2, and that would be the answer to this question. Okay? Okay, so now, once again, if you remember in the when we did forward kinematics, we started with 2D OF and then we expanded into the 3D OF. And what we want right now is this is an exercise actually that for you once again to develop the equations for inverse kinematics. This is a workout. Workout meaning that you, it's a sort of a take home exercise. You need to learn how to develop the equations. We'd already learned the forward kinematics because it was quite easy. And you remember back then when we did the forward kinematics for 3D UF, we simply started with a 2D UF and we simply added one more frame. Well, similar plan here. Again, we're going to start with the 2D UF equations and then we're going to do something else and then we're going to end up with the 3D UF equations. I strongly suggest that you... Why is this link? Oh, let me... So let me show you this video. This particular video, I'm actually starting up right now. I'm gonna put the links to this video in my description of this video, so you can actually watch it yourself. It's a fantastic video on developing the robot kinematics equation for a 3D OF robot. Try to edit. So let me try to get the link out. So yeah, let me just copy it, the whole thing. Now is not a good time to do this, to hang. Okay, we're finally here. So this is the video. I'm not sure if you can hear the voice, but it's about 11 minutes video. I'll leave it for you to watch it yourself, but you can just Google the name if you wish. Three planar. I'm going to also put the link to this video in my description. So it walks you through the process of finding the three-dimensional or 3D OF inverse kinematics equation. And you will see that the process is relatively also easy, assuming that you already done the inverse kinematics for 2D OF. So you see, starting from this point right here, let me just throw away all this stuff. Then you can begin the process of finding the inverse kinematics for the third angle, which is theta 3. I'll let you watch that video on your own. You can pause right now, go and watch that video, and then you will see my point. Or you can do it in your own time. We are now ready to move on to the next and more important topic. As you can see, we are now on a 1.5 hour mark of this session, or almost 1 hour and 20 minutes, something like that. So the rest of the time, we will be talking about decoupling. That's how significant this method is. You see, you have some familiarity with algebraic equations or operations. You definitely have some familiarity with geometry, but then decoupling is a brand new concept that you may not have heard about it before when it comes to robot operations. Nevertheless, decoupling is the most is the procedure to use for any robot, including the ones we already covered. But it is usually used when those operations we've covered so far, geometry or algebra, are no longer possible. If you have a situation where we have a higher order robots, like 4R, that involves a lot of rotary joints, 4 rotations, 5 rotations, 6 rotations, then algebraic or graphical methods are no longer possible to use. So then, and the reason for that is because those angles will be tangled so much together, causing or creating nonlinear equations, that isolating them using algebra will become impossible. And also drawing them in the 3D world, drawing them graphically would require 3D drawings. That could be a little bit complex to do on paper. Maybe you have to do complex modeling. That could also, in the end, becomes a little bit difficult to do. Other techniques to do this is not to find the formula, but rather to solve forward kinematics of every instant using software. Like you take the values from X, Y, and Z and you break it and you basically you increment them and you find forward in every instant in between. Once again, that solution is not ideal because it would require very powerful computers, and also it does not work or does not help you. Maybe you can use it for position, but then what if you want to do velocity and acceleration? You need formulas for those as well. You see, one of the reasons why we developed equations for position analysis is not just to find the position, but we can take these equations and then we can use them to develop equations for velocity and acceleration. We did something like that in earlier courses in our mechanical engineering studies, like in theory of machine. We again did something like that. We started with position analysis and then we integrate with respect to time, and then we find the velocities, and we did it again for accelerations. And this is exactly what needs to be done here. So the purpose or the target is that we must develop equations in order to do position and velocity and acceleration analysis later on. So what is decoupling? So obviously, graphical and geometry will not work, so we need to work with decoupling. So what is decoupling? So this is the T matrix for the 3D OF planar robot, as you can see from here. The three angles are so much tangled together that it's not possible to find algebraic solution. Meaning, those position right here at the end, right? I mean, the first value right here, which corresponds to Px, is impossible for us now to isolate theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3 into a separate variable. And mind you, these are only three variables, theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. So these, although there are three angles or three variables, and we have three equations, x, y, and z, but we still cannot solve it because they are tangled together. This is what meaning by tangled together. So they are so sort of glued together that we cannot simply isolate them using algebra. So that is why now we were going to, in other words, you can say that these angles are coupled together. So in order for us to solve the system, we need to decouple them. And that's what the name decoupling came from. In reality, the term coupling and decoupling has nothing to do with relationships. It basically has to do with the railroad industry. Essentially, a train is made of several cars. These are individual cars that are simply coupled together. And the term coupled here means that this particular mechanism right here is the coupling that is holding these cars together, causing them to become what is called a train. If you want to isolate one car out or remove it from the train, then you'll have to decouple it out of the train. And that's exactly what decoupling means. And if you recall our operations about matrix operations, then we said that the robot matrix essentially is made out of individual frame matrices for every joint that are multiplied together. Well, that sort of look like this. Similar resemble, it looks like these angles or these frames are coupled again, right? So if you want to decouple one of them out, you essentially want to remove it from the multiplication. So that's essentially what I mean. If you think about it, it's similar to what we did when we created the robot matrix. We coupled all the joints matrices together by multiplying them in the correct order. And now to untangle these parameters, we will need to decouple some of them. However, if you simply just remove, let's say if here, right, if we just simply remove A4 from the equation, we no longer have a robot matrix. You see, the robot matrix, the original robot matrix, was defined by multiplying A1, A2, A3, A4. If you simply remove A4 from the equation, then we no longer have the same robot matrix anymore. Yes, this is simpler to work with, but it's not the same robot anymore. So we need to remove, or between brackets, remove A4, but not remove it at the same time. And this is achieved using inverses. By using inverses, we can achieve the same process. See here, on this side of the equation, we have reduced the complexity of the analysis. We have essentially removed A4 from the operations here. But then to maintain the validity of the whole system, we simply put it on the other side. And now we have on this side, we have put A4, but now on this side, we have now only three angles. So specifically speaking now, if you want to decouple an angle out of the system, you simply put it on the other side using an inverse. Okay, lovely. So to move further and understand what decoupling is, let's take a look at an exercise. And if this looks familiar to you, this exercise, because I asked you a few weeks ago or a few sessions ago to multiply these three matrices together and develop the T matrix for this. And I think this was at the end of symbolic operations. If you have done so, good for you. If not, then you will regret not doing so. So now we have this particular robot or these three joints, A1, A2, and A3. And we would like to work on this and develop the inverse kinematics equation. So if you did multiply all of these matrices together, you will come up with a very big matrix. I'm going to ignore the R part. I'm going to focus only on those guys, which is the L, the position part. And that will result in this matrix right here. D3 C12 plus A1 C1 and D3 S12 A1 S1. And as you can see, it involves all the parameters you see here except for C3. D3 is represented here, but C3 is not here, but it's actually in the orientation part. For those who did perform the multiplication, they will know what I'm talking about. Okay, what's the big deal? Now, once again, if you remember from the frame matrix, the result that we have developed here corresponds to the general frame matrix. So this part, this term right here is equal to Px, is that right? And Py and Pz. So as you can see, in forward kinematics, we have basically done this before, so this is the set of equations, Px equal to this, Py, Pz, and so on, which can be easily solved given the fact that all the parameters are given. These are the robot parameters, which is D3, A1, and C3, C12, theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3, and so on. Now, in inverse kinematics, however, the other way around is not available. In inverse kinematics operations, this is available to us. This is the given information. And this is the information that we need to find. So that's why it's not possible to solve because the angles are tangled, as you can see. So we needed to decouple it. So we're going to define a new term right now. This matrix that we have seen before, that we call it the template for the matrix. In this particular example, we're going to give it a new name. We're going to simply call it RHS, which stands for the right-hand side. So if you had A1, A2, A3, and you multiply them together, you're going to end up with this, the RHS. The RHS simply is this matrix right here, but we don't want to write this whole thing every time. Okay, and also one other thing, the RHS is the given information. It's the position and orientation of the end effector that you would like to find. Remember, in robot kinematics, in inverse operations, PX, PY, and PZ, and also NOA, right? NO and A are all given because they represent the position and orientation of the robot. So these are all here. You can see this is the P position matrix, and this is NOA. So this information are available to you. So this is actually mean that RHS is also available to you. So far, so good. So returning to our example, so if you take those matrices and you multiply them together, you're going to end up with this. Okay. To decouple a joint matrix, let's just call it AI, one particular joint matrix. We remove the joint matrix from the left side. And this is now the left side. This is the left side, right? And we move it from the matrix and we put it on the other side. So we multiply it on the other side here. And we maintain the order of multiplication as we go along. Now, one other thing. These are the decoupling rules, yeah? When you see the rules for the first time, it would sound confusing. But once we do the example, it will make sense. So how do you decouple? We decouple the first joint. When you decouple one joint, right? We remove it from the left side and we multiply it over the other side with its own inverse, okay? But then we'll have to maintain the order of multiplication. What does that mean? For example, if I remove A1, then its inverse must come before, right? So we have to put A1 or the inverse of A1 here. But if I want to remove this last one, then I have to put it on the other side, post-multiply. So that, and then the next rule is that decoupling must happen in steps. What does that mean? Meaning we cannot decouple two angles at the same time, or one here, one there at the same time. No, you decouple once at a time. You remove one angle, then develop the equations. If that's enough, good. If not enough, then decouple one more angle and then repeat. Now, that's probably will not make any perfect sense right now, but bear with me, and when we do the example, it will make sense. Finally, you can do decoupling from the beginning or the end. Basically, you can decouple A1, or you can decouple the last joint, as long as you remember the correct order of multiplication. If you remove the last joint, which is the last one right here, so you just simply put it on the other side, post-multiply. But if you remove the first robot, the first joint, then it will become on the other side, but it will be pre-multiply. Okay, so now let's return to our example. What do you mean our example? This one. We are given A1, A2, and A3, and we would like to develop the inverse equations. Okay, so... yeah, so here's the situation. This is A1 and A2 and A3, and they're all given, okay? And when you multiply them all together, it's going to result in a very complex matrix that does not help us at all. So there's no need to multiply them again. But this is the given matrix available to us that contains PX, PY, PZ, and NOA. Okay, awesome. So now let's apply the same rules again, but on this particular example. So we can either decouple A1. We can either decouple joint 3, which is the last one. We can either decouple this one by putting it on the other side here, or we can either decouple this one and putting it here in the front, pre-multiply. Or as you can see here, this is what happens when you decouple joint 3 by putting it in the back end here. Or if you want to decouple D1, you can put it here. Now notice what happens on this side. See, let's take a look at the situation when we decouple A3, yeah? Or the last joint. If you decouple joint 3, okay, it goes here, but then what's left with us is just A1 and A2. So it's just two joints here. But if you decouple A1 and you put it here, okay, fine, but then you leave us again with two joints. So whatever happens on this side will always be a simpler matrix compared to the one that we have in the beginning. Okay? So we cannot just simply do these two together. So what we're going to do right now, we're just going to start with this particular example, which is decoupling joint 3. We will do that first. Okay, so here is now decoupling joint tree. So if you want to decouple joint tree, that is going to look like this. So you're gonna, we will have A2, A1, and we will have the right-hand side multiplied by the inverse of A3, okay? So in order for us to continue forward, we need to do a couple of operations. First of all, we need to multiply A1 and A2, as you can see from here, okay? You already have the values for A1 and A2, so you can just simply go ahead and multiply. You can pause and do it yourself. Otherwise, here's the value. So A1 and A2 are right here. You can, hold on, yeah? Screenshot this right now if you want. You can save it on your screen. Okay, done. So now move on to this example. So once again, the very first operation we have to do is to multiply these two together. You already have A1 and A2. Take your time, multiply, and then once you do, you should then verify that this is the result. This is now A1 multiplied by 2, and I'll leave it for you to verify that this is true. The second thing we need to do is that in order to find the corresponding result here, we first need to find the inverse of A3. We were not given that inverse. We were given A3 directly. And I hope you can remember from the very first section or part of this, of the kinematics when we talked about the frame matrix operation, I hope you remember how to find the inverse. So then you can go down here and find the inverse of A3. So the right-hand side, if you remember, this is what I meant by the right-hand side, essentially the template of the frame matrix. That would require us to find the inverse. So this is the inverse of A3. Once again, this is the answer, you verify. So once you have the inverse of A3, and now you have this, so now we need to multiply. I need to multiply these two matrices together. Okay, multiply what exactly? Yeah, multiply these, NX, multiply by C3, and so on and so forth. You will have to assume that everything inside this matrix is available to you, but for now, we're just going to treat it as a variable. So when you multiply these two matrices together, you're going to get this. So for example, if you look at this first parameter here, which is 1, 1, which is corresponds to this row multiplied by this column right here, right? Nx multiplied by C3, yeah, right here, minus S3 multiplied by Ox. Yeah, that's correct. And 0, 0, then these two go away. And repeat the process and you get this whole matrix. And once again, verify this yourself. Okay, I'm going to say this once, especially to my classroom students. You might ignore the verify part. You might say, I don't have to really do it. I know it's true. I know that it's true because I did it myself and I verified it. The purpose of the verification is not for you to really verify it. I really don't need you to verify it. But what I meant for you to do is to practice matrix multiplication. And this is something we talked about in previous videos, that but the more you do, the easier it gets. And not only the easier, but the faster you become at it. And remember, in the future, when you sit for a test or whatever, right, then time management is key. So if you take your sweet time to do multiplication, you will not have enough time to complete the test. But again, if you rush through the operations, you will make mistakes. So you need to develop that balance between speed and accuracy. And that will only happen if you practice. So every time I say verify, I really need you to stop the video and verify it for your own good, okay? Okay, so I hope now that you did pause and verify. So now, okay, now you have done this whole thing, what's the purpose of all of that? Why did we do all of these operations? Well, let's just recap what we have so far. What we have so far is that we have these two, which is on this side, right? And we have these two, which is on this side. Is that right? And notice that they are equal. There's an equal sign between them. And therefore, because they are equal, then every term on each matrix is also equal. What do you mean by every term? It means basically every item. For example, this guy right here is equal to the corresponding term here. In other words, now we have an equation. NZC3 minus OZS3 is equal to 0. And similarly in other places. So from these coordinates, we can then develop new equations. But those equations will be much, much easier to work with. And then from those equations, hopefully we can develop our inverse kinematics equations. So let's see that in action. So let's just think about item 1-4 and item 2-4. What is 1-4? So this is 1-4 right here. And this is item 2-4. Is that right? And on the other side, that will give us this. So since these are equal, so this is actually true. This is the this is 1,4 and this is 2,4. Is that right? So this is A1, C1, and then A1, S1. Is that right? And if I divide these two by this, by if I divide equation, if this if we call this equation 2, and this is equation 1, which is something that we did earlier, right? Sorry, equation 1, yeah. And if I divide these two equation 1, I'm going to get this. Is that right? And A1 and A1 is equal. Can it cancel? So this is now sine theta 1 divided by cosine theta 1, which is tangent. Is that right? That gives us this lovely equation. And when you're thinking, what is lovely about it? It's huge. Well, let's take a look. This is given. This is constant, which is available to you. And this is part of the NOA, which is available to you, which is orientation. In other words, everything here is already available to you. Therefore, we can now solve and find theta 1. And therefore, theta 1 is now become an available value we can use to find others. So hopefully now you can see the point of using decoupling. Let's just recap what happened. In decoupling, or without decoupling, what we had was, we had this. See, we had A1 multiplied by A2 multiplied by A3 is equal to the right-hand side. Is that right? RHS. And you already have this match. If you've done the exercise like I told you, then you already have this complex equation that does not really help you at all because the equations are tangled. Is that right? We could not isolate the angles from each other. But by decoupling theta 3, which is what we did here, by decoupling theta 3, we are simply untangled one angle from the complexities, right? Then we were able to come up with this lovely equation, which is then equation for theta 1. Is this the only equation we can use? You need to look closely into every terms here and find out what you can in order to find more or other equations. In fact, there is. From item 1 and 3 and 2 and 3. So now 1 and 3 is this guy. And 2 and 3 is this guy. Is that right? On the other side, what we get is AX and AY. And once again, AX and AY are part of the orientation matrix and it's available to you. So then we can actually get this. We can simply get, we get this equation, which is formula for theta 2 is equal to A10 2 AY minus AX minus theta 1. I need you to verify this because this is not the final result. If you're thinking about it, I can actually show you right here. You can simply see that S12 divided by C12 is equal to AY divided by AX. Is that right? Well, that is actually tangent or T12. But if you solve that, that will give you theta 12. Is that right? Which is simply theta 2 plus theta 1. But theta 1, we already have it from the very first step. So then we can just minus theta 1. That will give us theta 2. This become ugly in the end, but since this equation, let me just erase this a little bit. This equation right here gives us theta 1, 2, which is theta 1 plus theta 2. Is that right? But theta 1, we already found it from the very first step. So we minus theta 1, we get the value will be theta 2, as you can see from here. And from item 1, 2, from location 1, 2, what is it? 1, 2 is 1 and 2. Oh, you mean here? Yes, from item 1, 2, we can get this is equal to 0. And then we can solve it and put it on the other side. We can then get 2 and 1. Sorry, 1 and 2 is the other way around. 1 and 2 is 1 and 2. 1 and 2. I think it's 1 and 3. OX and NX. Yeah, it is actually 1 and 2, but then this is S3. There should be a negative here. There should be a negative here. But anyway, this will be 0. Let's go to the negative. Yeah, there will be a negative somewhere here. But then actually, yeah, that's the value. We could have used other places. We could have used, could have used 2 and 2. Yeah, we could have used 2 and 2, or even we could have used 2 and 1. Yeah, again. So to find you the three, we could have used three other locations as well to solve it. So regardless of the mechanics of how the equations were developed, I hope by now you see how decoupling works. Decoupling works essentially by reducing the complexity of the matrix, the resulting matrices, and then we can use those to multiply and then find common terms, and then we can then use it to find, use those new matrices to find the equation. So once again, let's recap what's decoupling. When we started with this matrix, the resulting operation, when we multiplied A1 and A2 and A3, this was the resulting matrix, and this is the right-hand side. And obviously from this, we cannot find the values. Yes, we can see that PZ is zero, but then that is sort of not useful here. We cannot find the values for PX and PY. So that is why this was difficult. We were looking for thetas, yeah, theta 1 and theta 2 and theta 3. So quite difficult for us to find any values for theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. So because they were actually integrated. So that's why we applied decoupling. So we decoupled theta 3. We put it on the other side by simply first multiplying A1 and A2, and then we're finding the inverse of A3. Then we post-multiplied by the right-hand side, and then we developed this matrix. Then now side by side, we have these two sets of equations equal to each other. And now the purpose of decoupling is right here. By developing these two sets of matrices, and then now we have now two new equalities and or two new equations. From then, we can then look for commonalities or look for algebraic solutions, and that can then result in finding those corresponding equations. So by decoupling only one angle, we were able to find the corresponding frame matrices, or excuse me, inverse kinematics equations. So right here, this is now the inverse kinematics. I think there's a negative here, but you can ignore that error. And then basically, these are the equations that we use to find theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. And this is now how decoupling works. Okay, in this particular example, we only needed one decoupling step. For higher order, because this particular example of robot has only three angles, but if you have more complicated robots, such as 5 degrees or 6 degrees, you might need to do decoupling maybe twice or maybe three times. And in each one of those steps, you will develop another set of matrices equal to each other like that. So in this particular decoupling step, we found these two equations equal to each other. And from these two sets of equations, we were able to find these sets of equations. From these matrices, we were able to find those equations. Now, in higher order robots, maybe one decoupling step might not be enough. So we need to do this again. Decouple one more time, develop another set of matrices, and then from that, we develop another set of equations. And then for higher still robots, we might even need to do even three times in order for us to develop yet more equations, okay? So now let's take a look at an example of decoupling. So this is a particular pose that is given to you. Basically this robot essentially, this exercise is related to the same example that we've seen before, above or, you know, before, you know, okay? So since this is the pose that is given to you, which is the position and orientation, then find the corresponding values. You can call this numerical example. So this is the equations are already available to us. We can just plug in the values. And that's exactly what we show here. The question was is find the corresponding values for theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. So here's the equations, theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, and here's the formulas. And the values are coming from here. So this is Px, Py, and Pz. This is Nx, Ny, and Nz, and so on. This is Ox, Oy, Oz, Ax, Ar, Ay, and Z. We can plug in the values and calculate and find, and then we can basically find that the robot parameters are shown right here. You know what I mean? And then basically, that's essentially the values that you see here. Okay, so now let's take a look at another example of how an example of robot decoupling can come to you. This is now, these are now two different matrices. You have A1 to 3, which is the matrix representing the first three joints, joint 1, 2, and 3. And this is, by the way, this is a real example, yeah? This is a real example that I read in another book. And this is a matrix that representing the end effector, 4, 5, 6. You can call this the end effector, and you can call this the manipulator. Excuse me, the manipulator. And okay, so now what do we need to find here? Given the target position and orientation of the end effector, in other words, given the RHS matrix, the right-hand side, and theta 1, theta 2, theta 3, meaning every value here is given as well. Develop the inverse kinematics for equations 4, 5, and 6. Okay, so what's going on here? So although we have 6 degrees of freedom robot, in fact, 6 rotations, yeah, robot, the first 3 are available to you, are given to you, right? And then what you need to find is only the last 3 values using decoupling. What do you need to do? There's no numbers given to you. So what they mean by, basically what they really say is essentially develop the equations. The question says, develop the inverse kinematics equations for 4 and 5 and 6. You have to make assumption that the values for the first 3 values, the first 3 joints are also available to you. So once again, I'll give you a moment to think about this. Pause and then think about it for a while. Apply decoupling and then we will go through the steps together. Okay, all right, so let's move on. So now, from the given information, we can see that if I take these two matrices together, which is A123 and A45, and I multiply them together like this, that will give me the right-hand side. Is that right? But then this matrix is available to us because it's given information, as what the question said. These are actually given to us. Is that right? So if that's the case, I'm just going to put it on the other side. I'm going to decouple it. And since it came first, so it's going to be pre-multiplied, as you can see from here. Is that right? Okay, so in order for us to do this, first we need to find the inverse of this equation. That's number one. So this matrix right here, we need to find the inverse of it. And then second of all, we need to multiply. We need to perform this operation, this multiplication. So step number one, inverse. Step number two, multiplication. So let's do that. So this is the inverse of A123, okay? Once again, verify it. Once we have this, and then we simply pre-multiply it by the right-hand side, which is right here. So this is the inverse, this is the right-hand side. Multiply it, and then, and multiply. Now, before you do the multiplication, once again, we need to use our brains to take some shortcuts. You see, let's take a look at what the question wanted. The question simply said, find equations for theta 4, 5, and 6, okay? If I come here now and multiply everything, then you realize that sometimes we don't need to multiply everything. If you saw earlier, in an earlier example, right, when we actually, here, when we solved this, we didn't actually use the whole matrix. We only used selected items. We only used selected locations. Is that right? Only these, we did not, and the rest of the matrix we did not use. So in essence, the multiplications that we did in elsewhere, right, in all of the other locations, right, that was a waste of time. Is that right? And similarly here, in this example, before we actually do the multiplication, we need to do not multiply everything. Otherwise, that will waste a lot of our time. We need to be economical about it. Is that right? So this is the previous example, right? And these are the positions that we use. This is 1, 2, and this is 1, 3, and 2, 3, and 1, 4, and 1, 4, 2, 4. And this is the corresponding values here. And you can see that we only use these locations, and we did not use the rest of the matrix. So the rest of the multiplication that we did here was simply a waste of time. And some of you are already thinking this. The problem, however, is that we don't know which one we're going to use and which one we won't use. That's probably in your mind right now. See, right now we have the knowledge that, after you finish the example, only then we found that we only needed those individual or these locations. But before we started the question, we had no idea which sessions we're going to use. So then what do we do next? Well, there is a quick shortcut to that. Well, all we really have to do right now is that we can use a little bit of strategy here. We can then, knowing that A45, we can strategically select items that would provide the inverse equations. Now, A45, in this particular example, you see, in earlier example, we don't have the answer. Is that right? But in our particular example, if you think about it, if after I move A123 to the other side, and I multiply all of those together, right, that answer will equal to A45. Is that right? You can see it clearly here, right? So coming up to this point, after I do this multiplication, right, whatever we get is going to equal to A45, which is available to you. Is that right? And since A45 is available to us, we can then use that to our advantage to select important items. You can clearly see that this position, for example, is already tangled. It's already too complicated. Is that right? The same goes for this one, and the same goes for this one. These are already too tangled for us to do anything with them. So there is no point to even try to multiply them. Is that right? So let's just ignore those for a minute. Secondly, these are zeros, okay? And they might be useful, we could be, but then again, they cannot help us anything. They cannot give us any values. There is no variables here, there's just zeros. So whatever we get from the multiplication, they will be equal to zero. So this may or may not be useful, but here on the other hand, we have some simpler equations, C4, 5, and this is 5 and 6, and this is 5 and 6. Again, these are simpler, so therefore easier to work with. In fact, you can clearly see that there is one particular item that is actually very powerful for us. And that item, hopefully by now you noticed, that will be the key to this answer, which is right here. If you think about it, if from this position I can find C5 or, cosine of 5, then I can easily find angle 5. And once I find angle 5, they can easily come here and find angle 4. Is that right? Because these will be common, just divide S4 divided by cosine 4, I can get tangent, and then this can be available fine for us, right? And similarly here, these two positions, again, since angle 5 is available to us, I can easily solve and find for angle 6. You know what I mean? So this is the strategy that we can determine by simply looking at our solution. So that's why, essentially, this is our target. We can actually, from items, 1 and 3 and 2 and 3, we can find theta 5, and white items 3 and 1 and 2 and 1, we can find theta 4, and then we can, from either one of these two, we can find theta 6. Now, although I said that this is theta 5 is available to us, but I myself in the next slide I said that not recommended. So why is that? Sir, is there something wrong with cosine? No, there's nothing wrong with cosine. And if you remember in a few slides ago or a while ago when we talked about the 3DOF or a 2DOF, we definitely use cosine, all right? When we were talking about the graphical angle, we use the cosine angle for an earlier exercise. Go back. Right here. Yeah, we definitely use cosine. So not a problem. So what's the problem with the cosine? Well, the problem is that in this particular example, we had no other choice but to use the cosine. And we couldn't find a way to find the angle using tangent. So what's the problem with the cosine? The problem is that this particular headache right here, that this can give us positive and negative angles, that this could give us some sort of a headache. A more accurate result is using the tangent. So what's the procedure here? The procedure is, if you can find a way to use the tangent of an angle to find it, then use the tangent first. If there is no tangent whatsoever, then you have no choice but to use the cosine. So although 3 and 3 position is available, we can definitely find the cosine, but because we have the possibility of using the tangent here, then we can then basically solve this question. So let's see how we can do that. See, starting from this position, 1 and 3 and 2 and 3, if I divide these equations on each other, the cosine 6 will go away. Is that right? Because they are common. If I divide this position divided by this position, we're going to get tangent 5 or negative tangent 5. So that will actually be more accurate than cosine 5. So that is why we're going to use items 1 and 3 better than 2 and 3. So you can see now that we're going to use only these two items, 1 and 3 and 2 and 3. Next, once we do that, we can then come here, plug in the value for theta 5 and theta 6, theta 5, sorry, and we can actually use it to find theta 4. So we need 3, 1, and 3, 2. And then once you do find the values, then you can actually come back to either one of these two, 1 and 3 and 2 and 3, one of these two again, to use it to find angle 6, which is now, since now theta 5 is available, just pick one of these two equations and find. So as you can see clearly now, the rest of the items are not important or not or too entangled for us to do the operations. Also, we use the cosine as a last resort only and when no tangent is available. So as you can see, we only have about 4 locations to use, and therefore we only multiply the corresponding items. Since we only need 1 and 3 and 2 and 3, so we multiply only 1 and 3 and 2 and 3. So this is 1, and this is 3. We only multiply and find the corresponding values. We don't have to multiply the rest of the matrix. So this is essentially, we only multiply those locations, 1 and 3, 2 and 3, and then 3 and 1, and 3 and 2. And that's it. The rest of the matrix, we simply ignore. By doing so, this is what we found. R1 and R here means essentially the answer or something like that, or the result, yeah, or the resultant. So R1 and 3 is R1, 3, or, that would be essentially, if I take this first row multiplied by the third column and multiply, I will get this answer right here. And if I take R2, 3, then that will get the same answer. So essentially, this the second row multiplied by the third column again, that will give us this answer. And this is 3 and 1 and 3 and 2. Then using, now from now on and for simplicity, we're going to call all of this as R1, 3. That's it. Now, although this looks a lot, but once again, everything is available to us. X is available, 1 is available, 2 available, 3 available, because remember this question, this particular question, they already told us that the first 3 angles are available to us. So X, 1, and 2, and 3 are available. Y is available. 2 and 1 are available, available. These are all available, right? So rather than rewriting this again and again, we're just going to call this R13, which is resultant or result 13. Similarly, in every on all of these lines, because every one of these values is available. So R23 here, R31, and R32 is available to us. And that's it. So this is what I meant by the resultant. So if I want you to take a look at this, if I actually take this matrix right here, these two matrices, and I multiply them together, I'm going to get this matrix right here. This is a simplification of sorts. This R13 is the one that we saw here. This is R13. And R123 is right here. This is 3123. And this is 32, sorry. This is actually 3, 2, yeah. And then essentially this is 3, 1. And the rest of the matrix is actually, we don't need it. By the way, take a look at these and realize that these are the simple ones. Yeah, the simple ones. Imagine what happens if you had to multiply the whole matrix. So this is one of those examples where you have to use your brain a little bit and not have to multiply the whole matrix and waste a lot of time in matrix multiplication. Multiply only the units or only the items that you need. Okay, so now using this idea, so what do we need to do? And then now from position 3, 1, now from there on end, we do something very similar to what we did in the first exercise when we decoupled angle 3. Remember that? When we did this step right here, now we do it again here. So essentially, going forward, yeah. So basically from 3, 1 and 3, 2, which is these two positions right here, we can simply, this position right here, we can divide S5, negative S5 cosine 6 divided by, this is again typo, this should be cosine here, right? So by dividing, this is again cosine, yeah? So that gives us tangent 5, so essentially that's the equation for theta 5. And similarly now, by going to the other two locations, which is 1 and 3 and 2 and 3, which is essentially these guys over here, and then dividing by the values, we can then reorganize and we can then come to this. This is not the end, it actually comes to this next line, so it's all of this. If you want to keep it in this clean version, it's fine. If you want to write it in terms of the given information, so that's also fine. These are all the same thing. You just have to realize that all of this essentially is R13, and all of this is R12 and R23 for simplicity. And similarly, C5, once you find angle 5, then you can just simply come and divide it, and then you can find it from here, and we'll be good to go. And once again, notice that we have here, we have used the cosine inverse, because for theta 6, there is no other solution. We had to have found essentially the cosine. Sir, we could have done it from here. This is sine, and this is sine. This cosine is, oh wait, it doesn't work. So you see, for this particular robot, we could never use tangent in any particular order. So that's why we will have to end up using only the essentially the corresponding value. We could have, if you wanted, thinking that since now we have 4 and 5, and on the other side we have equations, we have R1, R11, we could have actually solved for the tangent of 6. Actually, really, we could have done so. Let me do that here, actually. But then that would require us to do the multiplication for that item, which I dislike to do. So let's just say that, just for the argument's sake, we could have done it. So essentially, we could have said that, C4, C5, and C6 equal to R12 plus, that's not possible. S4 and S6. It's kind of difficult now to isolate this because there's a plus sign, so yeah, difficult to work with. So I was right. So essentially, I was trying to find a way that we could end up with a situation where we have S6 divided by C6, but then because of the presence of this plus sign here, then that will be difficult to work with. So because of that, maybe, I'm not sure, but these are also zeros on all, both sides, so you can ignore it. So that's why, essentially, we will have to use no choice but to use the cosine 6, cosine angle to find theta 6. But nevertheless, after you do all of that work, then that will give you the equations for theta 4, 5, and 6 using decoupling. And I know, this equation looks complicated on this side, but everything or every item in these equations are all already available to you. Available information. So this is what I meant by, in the beginning of the slides, when I said the position, the coordinates of the end effector, x, y, z, plus other information. The other information, as you can see, are all inside these equations here. Would you believe it? This is basically the end of this inverse kinematics. Let me recap everything we've done so far. So in inverse kinematics, what I possibly didn't show is that, okay, now, We talked about how inverse kinematics is different from forward kinematics. We said that in order to do inverse kinematics, you need to develop the inverse kinematics equations. And the bulk of the discussion today was how to develop those equations. Because once you do have those equations, then we have already achieved our target. We take those equations, we plug them into the program of the robot. Then we are able to control the robot. We can tell it, if you want to go to position XYZ, okay, here's the value of XYZ that will correspond to the robot to turn, or the motor to turn into a certain angle or a certain value, and then you can actually control or will handle it from there. So once again, we talked about inverse kinematics. We said that in order for us to allow the robot to travel in a certain path, we need to have values of x, y, and z. Then in order for us to do so, we need to have the corresponding angle or robot parameters that will require us to do so. So finding the equations involve algebraic, geometric, and decoupling methods, or combinations of these methods. We talked first of all about the simple algebraic equations to find those equations or the algebraic methods. And these are usually for mostly linear or the robot that involve linear operations. We saw how this is impossible for articulate or convoluted robots or robots that involve three rotations or more in multiple planes. That will make it impossible for you to separate the angles. And then we talked about a couple of examples where we have a couple of examples of cylindrical, spherical, and also convergent from one robot to another. Then we spoke about geometry and how geometry can also be used to develop the equations, and we did that exactly to find the equations for a 2DUF robot. and 3DOF RAW. You know what? Since we do have the time, actually, I'm going to go through the video about the 3DOF. It's 11 minutes. We have about half an hour, but we in this 11 minutes, I'll run the video and then I'm gonna provide some commentary. So I'm back into the video in a minute. Let me just continue with the recap. And then the last part we talked about was decoupling. We said that decoupling comes from the idea of since the angles are tangled, okay, let's untangle them. So that's essentially the idea or the name of decoupling comes from the railroad industry and essentially into how if you have the angles are too complicated or too tangled to each other, how then do you isolate them from, this is the video we'll see in a minute. How do you isolate them and then using the concept of decoupling. And then we talked about how to do that. So essentially by using the inverse equation. So the summary of that was by simply doing this, we see this particular arrangement. Oh, this is a nice slide. So let's take a look at this slide here. And when you look at this particular arrangement, this will result, because the angles are all here, are all coupled, they will result in very complicated and non-linear equations that are difficult to work with. But by simply moving the value here and then multiplying again, this is simplified because now we have three variables only, and this is simplified because everything here is available, and this variable has moved here now. So that would give us a new set of equations that are relatively easier to work with. So therefore, we can then use it to find the equations we are looking for. Now, that how many decoupling steps we need to do, it depends on the number of degrees of freedom. In our particular examples we've seen so far, we were able to solve the system by using only one decoupling step. See, this example that we've seen so far, in this first example we've seen today, we solved it by simply decoupling the third angle, which is theta 3. And simply by doing decoupling, then we were able to find, we were able to do this, and then put these angles, put these matrices on this side. Then we were able to find the equations that we are looking for. And similarly, in the second example that we have seen here, we were given two sets of matrices, one for the first three and the second for the second three angles or gem variables. And once again, with one decoupling operation, we were able to do solve this matrix, this solution. We were able to find and develop the equations accordingly. Okay, so now that we have sort of completed the slides, but we have some time with us, so I'm going to actually show you that video that I talked about, which is how to find the robot, the 3 degree of freedom inverse kinematics. I'm not sure if you can hear the video, but I'm going to mute it anyway, and then I'm going to talk over it. This particular video is from Dr. Matt Marshall. It's an excellent video, and his other videos are also great. So let's carry on with it. So basically, obviously, to begin the process, we begin by drawing the x and y coordinates and recap how the 2DOF problem solution was found. So we agree that, obviously, this is the first link, L1. And this is now the second link, L2. Makes the speed a little bit faster. And then basically now, this is now L3. And so the position for this point is defined by two coordinates, which is x and y. And that also need to be in terms of three angles. This is gamma, which is the pose, which is the angle. So this is now theta 1. This is theta 2. And the last angle is theta 3. Gamma is the angle that is determined by the pose. If you remember, I said in the beginning that the end effector is defined by a position and orientation. So in this particular example, the position is px, py, and the orientation is defined with gamma. Gamma is the angle that is relative or is measured between the last link and the x-axis or the line parallel to the x-axis. So this gamma right here essentially is the angle that defines the in a two-dimensional world, yeah, the orientation of this line right here. Okay? So meaning when you start to do for 3D analysis, See, when we did the inverse analysis for 2D OF, we only needed the position and orientation. But for the 3D OF, we need to have now three variables, X and Y and gamma. Without knowing gamma to begin with, this will become not possible to solve this particular example, because you now have three unknowns, but on, if you try to find three variables, theta 3, theta 2, and theta 1, using only X and Y, then it's not possible using regular algebra or trigonometry. So that is why we introduce a new variable that also need to be provided, but only for 3D OF example, which is now gamma. Okay, so now this is essentially the three angles, and this is the situation. I think what's going on now is basically the it's explaining that this robot is made of 2D OF plus one more link. So in order for us to solve this question, we need to realize that we need to continue the solution from the 2D OF analysis. So let's continue on. So X is equal to A12, which is the length here, cosine 23, C23. Okay, so this is A12, which is L1, we call it in our drawing. A12 is the link between joint 1 and joint 2. And A23 is this notation might be familiar from theory of machine. So A23 is between joint 2 and 3, and so on and so forth. So last time we called this L2. So this is L1 cosine theta 1, and this is L2 cosine theta 1 and 2. This is essentially the x coordinate. This is the solution that we found from forward kinematics. And this is now A3 and 4 cosine 1 plus 2 plus 3, or the first three angles. Speaking for 3 hours, I definitely lost my, I needed to drink some water to refresh my throat. So this is now the Y coordinates, which is similarly, but using the side angle. And of course, gamma will simply equal to theta 1 plus 2 plus 3. So essentially, if you think about it, angle theta 2 is right here and theta 1 is also right here. So gamma is equal to the three angles together. So the target right here is to find the first two angles and then use that to find the third angle. So let's continue. Yeah, so essentially, sine gamma is obviously, gamma is 1 and 2 and 3, so it's the sine is the same sine. So once you find gamma, then obviously you can find 1 and 2, you can find this value. Okay. So far this is all forward kinematics and also defining gamma, which is essentially the three angles put together. So now, given X and Y and gamma, this is the requirement for 3D OF inverse kinematics. So we need to find theta 1, theta 2, and theta 3. And this is what is called, the links are also given. A12 and A23 and A34 are L1, L2, and L3 from our slides. So how do we proceed by it? So the first thing to proceed with it is that basically we're going to use the solutions that we found from the 2D OF solution. Yeah, this particular point right here, we have defined in our basically is the end of the robot for 2D OF. And I think here is going to draw that again, the 2D OF solution. Yeah, so once again, he's gonna recap now the solution for 2D OF solution. Let's move this along. So now this is now the 2D OF. Again, I think he's drawing the positive solution. Earlier drawing was negative. When theta 3 was there, it was a little bit difficult to see the solution. Okay, now this is gamma. And this is theta 3. Okay, let's go faster a little bit. Okay, yeah, I think let's slow down here. So now let's see what's going on here. Yeah, let's call this point P3. Why 3? Why not 2? Not sure, but just call it P3 for now, which is at the end of the second joint right here. So this point right here, or let's just call it step number 1, which is find P3. In other words, find the coordinates of P3. Find the x and y coordinates of P3. Okay? Assume we found it. So then x3 will be essentially x plus a3y cosine gamma. Okay. See, what's going on here? See, remember that x is given. X meaning the whole, this whole height is given. Is that right? And y is given. This is the coordinates of the ND factor. Is that right? And gamma itself is given. So if you find the x coordinates here, then you can easily find the difference, because the rest of the x you have, so that will be the overall length minus the px3 coordinates. Didn't press play. Oh, good. He's going to draw it here. Oh, thank you. So this is gamma, and this is A34 or L3, and this is now P. P as in this P right here. And this is P3, which is right here. So what he says that this is the difference between them. So essentially, X3 or Y3 essentially will be Y minus A34 cosine gamma. So since you're already at this point, so knowing gamma and knowing the final position, you can then find the corresponding values. So from these values, you can then find X3 and Y3. Okay, so what's going on here is that, first of all, what happened? So what happened is that you have to remember that this x is given because this is the x coordinates of the ND factor. And this y is also given because it's the ND factor. And gamma and gamma is given because it's a 3DOF problem. And this is L3 is given. So in other words, from these three equations, we can find already x3 and y3. x3 and y3 are essentially are the coordinates of this point. But the coordinates of this point, which is x3 and y3, are also the coordinates at the end of the 2DOF problem, if you remember that. So then we can use this to find theta 2 and theta 1 is exactly the same way from what we did in a 2DOF problem. Meaning, since now that you have the coordinates for x3 and for this coordinates right here, if you think about it, this particular problem now has become a two-dimensional problem, a 2DOF problem. If you recall our slides in a 2DF problem, we have the coordinates x and y, yeah, and we have L1 and L2. And then using those information, we were able to find theta 2 and theta 1. That's exactly what's going on here. And that's why the video is almost over, because what he's saying is that by the time you find x3 and xy, the problem is done. Because from here on in, essentially, it's a 2DOF problem. This right here is a 2DOF planar robot is exactly what we did in our slides when we did it together. Let me show you those particular. Let me pause this video for a second, and then if you go back, this is forward kinematics. This is the forward kinematics. So let me open the inverse kinematics. So if you recall that when we did the planar robot example, right, we came up with the equations, right, and right here, in order to solve this, we only needed x and y and L1 and L2. Well, that's exactly the situation we have here. So what we needed to find in order, what's basically the procedure to solve in a 3D, or if we need to do it in stages, on steps. The first step, we need to find the coordinates of this point, which is this particular gentleman called it P3 for x3 and then y3. I would rather call this P2 as in point 2. Maybe he started counting from here, P1, 2, and 3, and 4. But I would call this P0 and then P1 and P2 and then P3 for the ND factor. Or maybe this is the third coordinates. He's following the notation, which is 0 to 1 and 1 to 2 and so on. Regardless, if you get this point, and this point is available to you since x and y, which is the given coordinates, and gamma is available to you, so then you can quickly find it from these equations right here. So how do you do that? Well, you realize that gamma is the angle between x and y, x and the line itself. So you can simply draw a triangle here. That will actually give you the values using this equation, choose from this triangle right here. So x given, y given, gamma given, then you can quickly find the values for x3 and y3. Once you have the coordinates for x3 and y3, this the rest of the problem becomes exactly what is called a 2DOF planar robot. And then you can use this equation to find the equations for theta 2 and theta 3. And that's it. So that's essentially how to do, how to develop the inverse kinematic equation for 2DOF. I think in future slides, maybe I will add one more slide in my slides to do this a little bit clearer, or using the same annotations that I was using. In other words, maybe I will add one more slide just above here for 3DOF. Yeah, I think I will do so. But then I will just leave it for you as an exercise first, and then we'll come back and do it. I will show you the steps later on. Okay, so I think this is it for this video for today, inverse kinematics. We talked about developing the inverse kinematics equations. We talked about different methods of doing so, the algebraic equations. We talked about geometrically or geometry. And we also talked about decoupling. And once those equations are available, then just plug in the values and or use them for programming the robot. And we have one more slide or one more section on robot kinematics, which is will be in our next session. But that will be the final stage before we move on to robot control. So once again, I hope the content was helpful. And once again, make sure you do all the exercises and the tutorials and the workouts in order for you to capture what's going on. And then hopefully it will stay with you moving forward. Okay, if you have any questions, you can drop me a line down bottom, or you can email me, or if you are in my class. Otherwise, thank you very much for watching. So I'll see you in the next video. Take care.